The death toll from the wildfires that have swept through Maui Island climbs to 53. Dozens more suffered burns, smoke inhalation, and other injuries, and hundreds have been displaced. Lalaine Ignao with a full story.
Unprecedented wildfires continue to rapidly spread across the island of Maui due to very dry conditions from a drought, made worse by powerful winds from Hurricane Dora, churning more than 800 miles away. The historic town of Lahaina is almost totally burnt to the ground, according to officials.
Majority of that area is owned by Filipinos. You know, that's where they live, the houses. It's called the Lahaina Luna Road, and that adjacent town's adjacent street is home of the many Filipinos.
Maui's hospitals have been inundated with burn patients and people suffering from smoke inhalation. There were reports early Wednesday that some people jumped into the ocean to flee from the fast-moving blazes. Over 2,000 people have been displaced and have sought shelter in 4 emergency shelters set up across Maui. 3 large fires remain active and out of control, and a state of emergency has been declared on the island. First responders are in search and rescue mode. Filipino Dominic Sugitan lives about 30 minutes away from Lahaina. He hasn't heard back from his friend who lives there, and he's worried.
There's no communication out there. Cell phone lines are out. 911 emergency lines are out. Power lines are out. So it's really, communication is really slow coming out of there. And we're just praying that he's okay and others are okay.
Several blazes are also burning on the Big Island, a neighboring island to Maui. President Joe Biden and former President Barack Obama, who was born in Hawaii, have sent their prayers and condolences to the victims. Biden has ordered all available federal assets on the islands to help with the emergency response.
We have just approved a major disaster declaration for Hawaii, which will get aid in the hands of the people desperately needing help now. Anyone who's lost a loved one whose home has been damaged or destroyed is going to get help immediately. And I've directed that we assert support to these brave firefighters and first responders and emergency personnel working round the clock there, risking their lives.
Lalaine Ignao, ABS-CBN News, Hawaii.
Prosecutors have indicted suspended lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. in relation to killings in Negros Oriental in 2019. He has been charged with 3 counts of murder. Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla says the murder charges will be filed in a Manila court either today or tomorrow. Teves has been staying overseas for months now after being linked to the March 4 murder of Negros Oriental Governor Roel de Gamo. The Philippine government has also tagged him as a terrorist and froze his assets.
Authorities vowing to bring justice to a teenager killed by police in Navota City in a case of mistaken identity. 6 police officers have been detained and are facing criminal and administrative charges over the death of Gerald Jemboy Baltasar. The 17-year-old was shot dead by police August 2nd after they mistook him for a murder suspect. Interior Secretary Benher Abalos has ordered a review of procedures during police operations to avoid similar incidents from happening. PNP Chief Benjamin Acorda also visited the wake of Baltasar, assuring his family justice will be served.
Nandito lang ako para unang-una to extend our condolence. At the same time, to give assurance to the member of the family na wala tayong itatago dyan. When it comes to the conduct of the investigation, we will be exerting our effort na the truth will come out in the investigation.
Now, the mother of Jemboy Baltasar has arrived in the country. Rodaliza Baltasar flew in from Doha, Qatar, Friday morning with the help of the Migrant Workers Department. The DMW and the Overseas Workers Welfare Administration have pledged a combined financial aid of 100,000 pesos for the Baltasar family. They also vowed to shoulder the funeral and burial expenses of the victim.
Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri wants the Philippine government to exclude Chinese contractors in public infrastructure projects. Zubiri made the suggestion following China's bullying tactics in the West Philippine Sea. The Senate leader maintains Filipinos are unwittingly funding China's aggressive actions by allowing Chinese-owned companies to take part in government projects. Zubiri earlier called for a boycott of Chinese companies and products after the Chinese Coast Guard used water cannons to prevent a resupply mission to the Philippine Navy outpost in Ayungin Shoal.
A renowned Philippine urban planner warns of possible impacts of the government's decision to suspend all reclamation activities in Manila Bay. Architect Felino Palafox Jr. says this may affect foreign investments. Palafox has raised concerns on the impacts of reclamation in Manila Bay as early as 1976.
We are being monitored now by foreign investors. At Philippine Chamber of Commerce Industry, every day we meet with foreign chambers of commerce, even foreign ambassadors are investing in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. So my concern there is maybe the impact on foreign direct investment should also be addressed. And also the environment, concern for the environment. And we should have a balanced view. And since the word suspension, we get calls from all over the world now. Mm-hmm. That why is this? So maybe it must be explained properly.
Meanwhile, environmental group Greenpeace Philippines welcomes the government's decision to suspend Manila Bay reclamation projects. Greenpeace, however, asserts caring for the environment goes beyond putting a stop to harmful projects.
Even without the reclamation projects, we already have problems in terms of flooding. We need to actually rethink if we really need this kind of reclamation. If we're really serious about making the bay clean, making the environment good, and creating good livelihood. And so we need to look at every city's zoning guidelines. We need to look at land use plans and make it optimum to give the people what they need.